Keep still.
All right, now get up on your knees. Put your hands in your pockets. Keep them there.
Red wine with fish. Well, that should have told me something.
Do you expect me to talk?
So what do you guys think of this? I mean, I think out of all the Connerys, this is actually my personal favourite.
It's Connery's favourite. And Terence Young's favourite too.
And John F. Kennedy's too.
And John F. Kennedy's, but he wasn't part of the cast and crew, admittedly.
No, he wasn't. But yeah, this routinely tops the list of top 10 favourite Bond films and books. And
I think,
it's quite weird because it's not... Out of all the Bond films, particularly Connery's, it's the one that's least structured like a Bond film. It's the one that feels less kind of traditional, which is slightly odd when it comes to the Bond franchise. But yeah, it's still like Connery's best.
You'd expect them to be moving closer to formula, but
yeah,
actually taking a step further away.
Yeah.
Since Dr. No last week, with one exception, certainly the opening of the film, we're starting to head towards the traditional sort of Bond.
Yeah, it opens with Gun Barrel, and then it has like a title sequence, and it kind of has like the James Bond theme, and then it goes into belly dancing music.
I love the way it goes into that theme, because it actually, that must have been so exciting for audiences in 63.
It was amazing, completely.
No TV, no DVDs, nothing like that. They won't have seen it since theatres the year before. And then suddenly it just crashes into it. You've had a pre-title sequence with a fake out, where basically, for those who've not seen it, Sean Connery is in a garden on what we later find out is Spectre Island,
which is like gardens at Pinewood Studios.
Fun fact,
it's actually Heatherden Hall, which was Pinewood Studios.
The first time you see Sean Connery, something is slightly off. He looks over made up. He's very pale. And he's got sort of very, very pink lips.
Yeah.
And it's basically because...
It's a mask.
It's a mask. It's Sean Connery.
I mean, it is actually Sean Connery acting. I mean, there's no question about that. And one of the things I kind of picked up on was actually, we don't think of Sean Connery as a good actor. You know, we see him more as a movie star. But I think he actually acted really well in this. Seeing that he's playing like someone who's pretending to be Bond, and he's not very Bond-like, actually. If you actually look how he moves...
He looks extremely nervous during the sequence.
Yeah, he doesn't even... He moves differently. He moves like a different man, which I thought, oh, well, good on you. You actually are acting. You're actually getting in the role of someone else. It's quite... Yeah, I thought I was actually mildly impressed, you know.
Yeah. So, as I say, it's said at night, it ends up with Bond, in inverted commas, being garrotted by...
Quint.
Quint from Jaws. Unrecognisable if you don't know. I think if you watch Jaws and then watch this, I don't think you'd immediately recognise it as the same guy.
He's very young in this, isn't he?
Yeah.
He looks young.
He would have been about 36, something like that.
Yeah. But he's in peak physical condition.
Yes, he is. It starts the sort of trend of Aryan henchmen, and obviously the sequence ends with a mask being lifted off the face of the dead man, and it was all a training exercise for Spectre, and it really sets up, not only do we crash into the credit sequence musically, but we've also set up this film is, I mean, they say we've never had a Bond sequel until Quantum of Solace. It is linked to Dr. No. They sell this very much as them trying to get revenge for what he did to Dr. No in the previous film.
But it even carries on, because you see the... Sylvia Trench.
Yes. Because that was going to be a running theme for all of them, wasn't it?
Yeah,
it was going to be like... It was always going to be like the girl who's on a date with, and he always gets called away. Mm. It's like, oh, they nearly do something, or he's always like... With her, and it's like, oh, M's calling, sorry.
She's signed for six.
Yeah. This is a second and last appearance. What do we make? I mean, like, are we sad? Are we glad that this didn't become, like, a regular thing?
I don't think it lasted long enough for us to really
care.
Yeah, I mean, had it gone on much longer, it might well have become one of the series tropes.
Mm.
That, you know, that sort of
interrupting
his date with whoever the Bond.
Yeah, I'm trying to picture who, if it got to like now with like, it was like Brosnan or Craig, you know, and it was still like still trying to have a date with Sylvia Trench. It's like, would that still work by like today's standards?
No,
I don't think so. No. The things I always note about the Sylvia Trench scene are the Bentley. Because the Bentley was his car in the books.
Mm.
And also it had a car phone, which must have been phenomenally
flash,
high-tech and exciting at the time.
Very high-tech.
So, yeah, he's called in through his car phone.
Yeah. See, Bond's setting, you know, the trends for the technology of today.
And then in Goldfinger, you have the GPS, or kind of a very first GPS of a sort.
Fucking hell, Bond's just been inventing everything, hasn't he, really?
Q Branch, that's...
Yeah. Yeah.
We've never seen him use a disposable barbecue, though.
That's the one.
But, he's called in via his phone, and that's the last we see of Sylvia Trench, having been signed for 6 films, and I do wonder... Without stepping on the toes of next week too much, it's because we have a change of director next week.
I'd guess that. Cause...
He dropped that. So, I mean, I don't know that for certain, but possibly had Terence Young directed Goldfinger, we may have seen her again.
I agree, but then also you have the camaraderie between Bond and Moneypenny as well. So whether that carried on, had Bond had, you know, a date du jour at the start of each film, so...
Yeah, quite possibly.
Just an idea.
What, have like Bond always going on a date with Moneypenny?
Mm.
That'd be good.
I don't know. I mean, like there was like I don't think I talked about this last week, but there was like this. Lois Maxwell talked about like they actually had a backstory for Bond and Moneypenny, they made up like their own history that isn't actually in the film, but it's what they go to act with, and it's like, oh, they did have this thing, but it came to the point where she didn't want to fall in love with someone like him because he knew that the job will always come first, or something along those lines.
Yeah, the idea is that they had a tryst in a sort of country cottage, didn't they? And then, she didn't want to fall in love with him, and then he didn't want to let himself fall in love with her because he'd break her heart, and you think, oh, that's the kind of backstory going on there, and that's why you see this great push on between them.
Yeah.
I love the story. The only detail of it I'm not that fond of, although it stands out like a sore thumb, is she says something along the lines of, you know, when she was a lowly typist and he was working in the tea room or something. And I just thought MI6 recruited the Royal Navy to make the tea.
I know, I just picture a Connery in a penny, just like...
This isn't how I imagined the Secret Service, damn it.
Biscuits?
Biscuits, anybody?
Biscuits. Yeah. Milk? Sugar?
I remember once watching it, I was sat reading like a magazine or something and the TV was on, and this shockingly awful Sean Connery impression came to, like, I noticed them, you know. I just thought, who the hell is that? And when I looked up, it was Sean Connery. So Sean Connery does a really shit impression of himself.
Oh no. He probably sends himself up now.
His voice has changed quite a lot over the years, to be fair.
I think the most recent thing he's done is like the Sir Billy animations, where he's like a Highland vet.
Yeah.
And
he retired from acting after.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. She's a shame.
League of Extraordinary Gentlemen was his last live action film.
Oh, yeah. I remember seeing that at the cinema and thinking, oh dear.
Yeah, he thought that as well. Didn't get on with the director, never made another film. He has a history of that in later years. I mean, he didn't make a film for 3 years after Never Say Never Again because he didn't enjoy it. There's a couple of such sort of gaps in his career where he just hasn't had time.
I gather he might have enjoyed, I don't know, Never Say Never Again more than he did Thunderball, but I say we'll discuss that when we actually come to Thunderball.
I guess, but that's another 2 episodes away. So, where we start? Yeah, so... From Russia with Love starts with the gun barrel opening scene and Sylvia Trench last appearance. it's kind of odd because actually, there's actually like it's when you have to. It takes quite a while for us to actually to get to Bond itself because actually, the first like 10 minutes or so is literally just Spectre just setting up their plan and introducing them there, introducing Blofeld and then and seeing like
Kronstein.
Hmm.
Kronstein as well.
Oh yeah, what the master chess player? Yes. Yeah. Which is it's kind of weird because it kind of feels like of all the Bond villains in this film, which are actually quite a few. So it's kind of nice little collective. He's the one that feels like it easily been cut out. I mean, like, well, okay, fine. It was his plan, but let's face it, we could have just had Blofeld make the plan.
Yeah. Did anyone? We have actually seen Blofeld already in this series. The body of Blofeld, not the voice, but the body.
Professor Dent
from last week, the geologist who put the tarantula in Bond's bed.
Did you see his hands and like the back of his head?
You see the hands and the back of his head. Blofeld does have hair in this film.
Yeah.
He does.
And
then you have to wait a while. You've got some bald chaps.
The Kronstein scene is another really good set, and it's the first sign of a vastly, a doubled budget this time.
$2 million.
$2 million instead of $1 million. Yeah, and that set cost $300,000 to make. The chess room for about 2 minutes of screen time.
Jeez.
It's a lot of money, jeez.
It's an enormous amount of money. And, I mean, the top part of it's matte painting. But, again, immediately we can see there's a bit more money to play with.
Well, the whole film is a bit more, like, bolder as well. Cause you got, I mean, I'm watching it now, it's... you know, coming from Dr. No, it does feel like a lot more like, well, let's be a little bit more brave in our decisions. You know, it's like, we'll have the gun barrel, we'll play all these new things. So it very much feels like it's very much confident in itself.
It's more
wrapped
up, isn't it?
Yeah. I think that's just, I think that's what it just adds to the enjoyment of it. Because it's just so like, yeah, we're doing straight in. It's a really, we've got a plot. You know, it feels like a spy film. It does generally feel like a spy film.
It's a cold war, sort of thriller, isn't it?
Bit of revenge, So it's good. I mean, I think it's probably Connery's best performance as Bond. But I guess I mean I say that after not rewatching the others. But I think he's Connery's greatness.
I kind of go a bit back and forward on Connery's best performance in this role. Certainly. I've always really liked him in the first half of Dr. No, but I will make different cases each week for things he did well in each film. Actually, I mean, when we get to Thunderball, I've got some observations about what a physical performance it is, but I think this is probably the most balanced performance. There's scenes we'll get to later, which although they make me feel a little bit uncomfortable, a couple of the scenes on the Orient Express.
I think I know which scenes you're referring to.
There's one scene in particular where he's doing some of the best work of his career. So yeah, you talk of the plot. Actually, it's elements we see again through the series. The sort of it is a MacGuffin, really. They want they're after the
Lector.
The Lector.
That's the one.
Which is actually called the Spectre in the book.
It is.
Yeah, but of course the villains were Smirsch in the books. This was before Spectre had even been thought of.
Is there a reason why they weren't called Smirsch, or is that because it was Russia?
That's like the real-life anti-spy Russian vehicle, and then they kind of moved it to the more kind of Spectre, who was still villainous, but obviously in the middle, so they could play Russia and, you know, East and West off against each other.
So, just to get me clear, because I've not read the books, and I might Blofeld, is he in charge of Smirsch or is Spectre in the books?
No, Blofeld comes along. There's basically a Spectre trilogy, if you like, of books. You've got, I think it goes Majesties, then You Only Live Twice, then... What's the last one? But yeah, there's a Spectre trilogy later on. Basically, Majesties is something like...
No, it's Thunderball. It's Thunderball, Majesties, Twice, because it's...
Sorry, yeah, no, it confused me because... That's right, you're right, because we'll get to that again in a couple of weeks' time, because how the hell did I not remember that was Thunderball? Thunderball was the whole reasoning behind the lawsuits over Blofeld and everything. Sorry, yeah, it was Thunderball, then Majesties, then You Only Live Twice. And that I think Thunderball is something like the seventh or eighth book. So we're quite a way down the line from this one. This book comes just before Dr. No, funnily enough. And the thing I recall, you mentioned sort of at the top of the podcast that we don't see Bond for a while.
No.
That's true in the book as well. But it is a very, very faithful adaptation. Of the ones I've read, and I'm still missing two or three at the end, From Russia With Love was comfortably my favourite book.
It's easy to know why, because it is quite a good, solid plot as well.
It works on the page.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Took the words right out of my mouth.
But I reckon in the book, the whole relationship between I forgot her name.
Tanya.
Yeah. Sorry, what's it again?
Tatiana.
Yeah, the relationship with Tatiana. I reckon that plays in the book. It reads like a little bit more like, oh, he don't quite know if he can trust her or not, but how much he's playing her. In the film, it kind of just feels like she just falls over him instantly, in a kind of weird kind of way. Particularly when we get to the scene in the train, she's pretty much like, oh, James. Protect me, Will. You know, which
In the book, it's worth reading the scene where she's given the assignment by Cleb. Simply because the film kind of slightly hints that Cleb might be a lesbian.
Yeah, it's very creepy, but in the books, it's kind of
in the book, explicit. She flat out is.
It's the same as Pussy Galore as well. That's much more explicit in the book as well. That's made much more obvious.
Yeah.
I think it's definitely there. It's just. They don't, obviously. I mean, in the book, you can kind of like you describe things a lot more, but in here, it's like he instantly tells when one of the men in from Spectre like just touches like her on the arm in like in the slightest way. She's kind of like, oh, what's that? But then in the next scene where she's like talking to Tatiana, she's there like sort of touched her leg and go, oh, okay, and then and then just like and just like always
in the book, she flat out tries to seduce her. I think she may even put on like a nightgown or something. I can't quite remember. Tanya ends up like running away.
she escapes. She's lucky to escape.
So From Russia With Love doesn't have Blofeld as a villain, but arguably this film doesn't either.
Yeah,
this film is actually central villainless. It's all henchmen.
Yeah, you got Clev and you got
Kronstein.
That's the one.
And Red Grant.
Yeah. And what's the other dude?
What other dude?
The guy training Spectre Island.
Oh, Walter Goodtell's character. I can't remember his name off the top of my head. It's not the same character he plays later on. We will get him again in the Moore era.
Is it Morzini? I can't remember his name.
Morzini, absolutely right. It is.
He pops up again, does he?
He's in several of the Roger Moore films.
Yeah, because he plays Gogol as well, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's General Gogol.
Shit, no way.
Yeah.
But the one who calls Barbara back at the start.
Gobsmacked.
Yeah, he's in about six or seven. He's in about six Bond films after this.
That guy looks in Russia. He looks like he's a really tall fella. Like General Gogol looks like he's pretty much a short ass.
Yeah, admittedly, he's short. He sat down in most scenes.
Oh, really?
By the desk.
But yeah, so he does sort
same,
of...
Yeah, same actor.
It's funny that, I mean, when we get to the Moore era, they're a lot more comfortable using Russians as sort of the bad guys. Sort of.
Rivals, but, you know, but it's mm-hmm. it's like Inspired Love Me. It's like, it's rather than being like, actually, like they acknowledge that they are kind of semi at war. There's tensions between the two, and they kind of
and the dangers are actually with people who are KGB trained and sort of not able to be kept on a leash, but
the villains are always kind of almost like always working outside of that, really. Yeah. So
but I mean, at the point that they would have been shooting From Russia With Love, it would have been early in 63. We'd have been 14, 15 months after the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think at that point you could have had the sort of cartoony villainy of Smirch.
It's still very much real.
Yeah, when there were real tensions there.
Yeah, it's probably a wise move. But then, the movies industry's always done that, though, isn't it? And it's just, I suppose it just makes sense. Just like, well, we're not going to point fingers. We're just going to just isolate a separate terrorist or separate group that's completely fictional that are doing it. So
it's interesting, you know, geopolitics do inform Interbond. So it's just quite interesting.
Yeah, and hence why GoldenEye was such a high risk film at the time, post Cold War. The Cold War does define this series to a large degree, even though
Pierce Brosnan's happy shooting Russian soldiers.
Well,
yeah.
Yeah. He just but they just shot his mate, so he just. Yeah. But yeah, I think even though quite often it would be a megalomaniac as the bad guy outside of that system, there is no doubt that these are Cold War era films.
Definitely.
All right. So where are we to now? Russia takes its time bringing Connery. Connery gets introduced. We get our first introduction to Q in this.
The first Desmond Llewellyn's Q, yeah.
Yeah, he's great.
And his first gadget is a briefcase. Cheers.
Memorable scene.
Yeah, it's not the Q Bond relationship we've come to know. That comes along next week.
But
it's kind of more of like traditional. I just, you know, go in, give her your tech, and get out. It's not very much, you know, I'll pay attention to 007 and do bring it back in one piece. And...
Well, the role was pretty much last minute. It was like he got the calls. Oh, can you come in and just do this like one scene? So like, okay, fine. It was like, and then being what a random call to get, because he made his career basically.
I don't know if it. I haven't looked. I don't know if either of you know why it's not Peter Burton again. Peter Burton, who was the quartermaster last week, because this is still a relatively small, nondescript role at this stage.
Mm. Yeah, I'm not too sure about that. Actually, I have to look into it.
I would have thought it might well have been a clash, but yeah.
Maybe he wasn't available, and they drafted Desmond in.
And thank goodness they did, because there was a period of time where I couldn't even imagine this series without Desmond Llewellyn. Obviously. Time goes on and things change, but he was so central to the identity of this series for years.
I completely agree. I mean, he is Q. I mean, you've got Ben Whishaw now, but nobody can replace Desmond Llewellyn. It's a real credit to the series.
John Cleese actually did a good job, though, admittedly.
Yeah, it was odd, wasn't it? It was quite funny, but I don't know.
I mean, I think if it won, what I think if you're going to praise Die Another Day, for anything, I do remember the bit where the new Q, which would be John Cleese, did seem pretty seamless. It didn't sort of feel weird in any way. I guess we keep saying this. We'll get to it when we get to Die Another Day.
As a teaser for that episode, I will praise the MGM logo at the start.
Oh yeah.
After that, it's a bit down.
That's the best part. And then, I don't know. The Q scene is always a highlight of the film, and yeah, for Mushroom of Love, there's no exception really.
I don't know. I mean, it's just basically just a briefcase. Like, don't look here. There was only got a briefcase, got a rifle, and some gold coins, and a flick knife.
But he uses those sulfurs to bug for his life.
And we've got some talcum powder that explodes in your face. Ha ha. Okay. And then goes, thanks, Q. Okay, bye. He just walks out.
Yeah, it's actually a pretty nondescript scene as well, this one, at this stage. We do get a much, much better scene with Emma later on, which I'm sure we'll get to in a little while. Of course, at this point, he's sent off to Istanbul to start his mission, and he is partnered up with a really, really wonderful character, Ali Kerim Bey, played by Pedro Armendariz.
Yeah.
If I pronounce it correctly. Really, really one of the saddest elements of the saddest element of this film is Armendariz's story. Right at the very outset of shooting, he's told he has terminal cancer.
That's really sad.
Mm. They filmed all his scenes within about 3 weeks. And there are scenes in this film where he is literally being held up. Where there's close-in, sort of waist-up shots, quite often he's being held up by somebody. And he was dead months before the film's release. He checked into a clinic in the United States, smuggled in a gun and shot himself to avoid the worst of the pain. So really cast a pall, because the film was still in production when he died. So, yeah, really sad story. And the greatest respect to the act you can pay to the actor is the fact you cannot tell. You cannot tell at any point that there's anything wrong with him.
No, he was happy to go back and redub his lines, isn't he? Even though he's really poorly. He was happy to go back and reshoot scenes and redub
his lines. He did all his ADR work, yeah.
Yes, he did.
I think, I mean, it's testament as well, the fact that he's actually one of my favourite of Bond's allies.
Definitely.
Yeah, there's just something about him that it's just like, even though you know he's pretty much like a shady character, but he's one of these like friendly, shady characters. So he's just like, hey, I like instantly can trust you. He's like helpful and friendly. And he has this kind of code thing like, well, I basically keep everything in my family. Like everyone who works for me, like sort of. Like,
you're all my sons.
Literally are related. He's like, you know, because blood, you know, you can't get thicker than blood, you know. I know I can trust him, you know, and he's just
so much more impact than the 7 or 8 Felix Leiter interpretations.
Oh, yes, that's true.
Exactly.
With a couple of exceptions. I mean, certainly David Hedison in License to Kill.
But even like pretty much in his last scene where he's there, like talking to the that Russian.
Wait,
exactly.
I'm going to piss you
off. You would? Oh.
Yeah, that's, you know, that whole tone.
Well then.
Did you recognise, of course, he survives a bomb attack because he's basically not sat at his desk, he's having sex.
Oh yeah.
The woman he's having sex with, the one who's Ali Karen Bay, that you'll see her next week. She's the belly dancer in the pre-title sequence to Goldfinger.
Bonita, of course she is.
That he spins to take that smack on the head.
God. Human Same shield. Actress.
Which sort of adds to that feeling that we've got a bit of a sort of almost a repertory company here in these early films. Yeah. A lot of the same people coming back again.
Yeah, it's like you were saying last week, you've got a company of films, the same cast, same crew, almost.
First truly great John Barry Bond score as well.
Definitely. It's one of my favourite. I love the music from Russia with Love. It's just amazing. I love John Barry, period. But Russia is just one of my favourite scores ever.
Forever.
Just let you know that.
I think from here, you know, people often talk about sort of when they talk about John Williams and they say, well, you know, that sort of 75 to 82, 83 spell where just everything he did was gold from Jaws through E.T. I can't think of it went any further than that. And I think really from here through about Diamonds, you've got Barry's golden era for me.
Oh, for sure. Definitely.
He also won an Academy Award during this time, I believe, for Midnight Cowboy. So, yeah, this was a very, very fertile period for him.
Amazing score.
Mm.
I have to convince you guys to get into John Barry. It's just amazing.
Well, I've got a couple of his scores.
Oh, good. Well, I'm glad to hear that.
I've got the Majesty scores, and I've got the Somewhere in Time score.
Oh, brilliant.
Which is outside of this era, actually, because that's about 81, 82.
Yeah, but still very good, though.
So. It's still superb, yeah.
So that's really big brassy brass sounds and the percussion and just the swing kind of jazz element of it as well really makes it stand out.
It's weird because like whenever you're watching a film that's not a Bond film and you hear a piece of music, you're like, oh, that's kind of like a Bond film. That's John Barry.
Yeah,
it's like out of Africa. You think, oh, that sounds like it could be in a Bond film. It's John Barry.
Exactly. I've got one of his later albums. I want to say Echoes, I think, maybe late 90s.
Okay, you're not confusing him with Pink Floyd, are you?
No, I would have to look this up, but but yeah, I would have to look it up. But yeah, it's like kind of, I think it's an album of like original music. And it does sound like, some of them do sound like they could be Bond themes.
I mean, this certainly, I know the Goldfinger will certainly have its fans, but this to me is his strongest from the sort of first four. I think his best three Bond scores come in a row a bit later on, But this is the strongest of the first four for me.
I think also what helps is not...
Eternal Echoes, that's what it's called, sorry.
I think also it helps the fact that it's not reliant on anything else as well. Because like in golfing, you've got all the other elements of all the other regular Bond tropes that start coming into it.
Mm.
This is like the least tropey of the Bond franchise. And it kind of just speaks for itself.
It does. Of all my favourite Bond films, this is actually the one I can watch least, because you've got to kind of concentrate.
Mm.
You can't let it wash over you like comfort food in the same way as maybe a Goldfinger. It doesn't have those sort of familiar signposts on the way.
But it's still action packed. Sorry, go on back.
No, sorry, I was going to say, it's quite twisty turny as well. You do have to pay attention.
Mm.
And it's still action packed as well. I mean, it does feel like... It does feel very tightly knitted, like there's a bit of plot, there's a bit of like a little bit of action scene, there's something interesting, Red Grant's up to suspicion, and then there's a huge fight scene, bit of plot, fights. It just feels very much like it's giving you like a nice little mix of everything, so it gives you like a bit of plot, bit of action, bit of plot, bit of action, bit of plot, bit of action. It feels like a very nice sort of pacey kind of story, and it's just really well done. What I really liked about the character Red Grant, I will say, is the fact that he's pretty much like you never hear him speak up until the train bit, and he just talks.
That's not the voice you're expecting to come
exactly.
out.
Exactly, it's like he's just like, oh, hello, old chap, and it does make you wonder. The fact is, when he does reveal himself, is he going to go into like full like Russian or sort of kind of like a little bit European like kind of accent, but he kind of doesn't. He makes you think, is that his real voice? Or it's really weird.
Mm. Yeah, actually in the book I believe he's Irish.
Oh, because Red Grant
is actually Irish, and he's kind of a mercenary. I've not read the book for a few years, so I'm sure people listening may correct me on that, but
I could buy that as well.
Yeah, I mean, the book gives him a backstory. The book, you do find out sort of how he ended up where he is. The film doesn't do that, and it's actually all the stronger for it.
Yeah, you didn't give him that backstory. You don't find out too much about him.
And if it makes him more, well, that's always best, makes him more sinister as well, particularly like in the first half where he's trailing Bond, and it's like, you know his orders, but... You know, it just makes him a lot more sinister.
But he's a hired killer. I mean, but he is a hired killer.
Yeah.
Whereas,
I'm ruthless. Like, just stole a car and killed a dude for it. You know.
But the thing that actually tells you he's just a hired killer, though, is the fact that he orders red wine with fish.
Well,
that's how you know he's a spy.
Well, I don't know. I mean, that's the common thing. But after watching this, I'm not sure. If that's the reason, I think the line of dialogue is when he reveals himself and he's like, "Red wine fish, I should have known," or something like that. I think that's more of like a joke that Bond picked up for. Oh, that's a bit odd. Why you guys red fish with red fish? He said red wine with fish. And
but
then,
his training is killing, not infiltration. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, I don't know. I think From what I see from the film, it's like it's Connery's Bond is kind of like almost like making a joke, saying, "Oh, I should have known some of that poor taste." Got to be like a rather than actually being a serious thing. Because I don't know, he does pick up on the fact that he dropped something in Tatiana's drink, which is not the most subtle way either. So.
It's really obvious.
Yes. Exactly. So I think that's what gave him away, because after that he kind of blags in the fact that I can't take her with me, but let me show you my route.
Yeah, now get on your knees.
Yes, yeah. And so
with your neck exposed, and I'll show.
Yeah,
you.
So Bond actually still buys it. You know what I mean? So that whole like red wine thing kind of still stands for me. So, but anyway.
And then, of course, you've just mentioned them. They go back. Tatiana's drugged. Well, they're on the Orient Express, and I don't know about you, but I'm struggling to think of a bad Bond theme set on a bad Bond sequence set on a train.
No, I think generally Bond on a train is a
they good generally thing. Work.
Yeah, it's really good. We've got a claustrophobic atmosphere, and it's just really tense and probably one of the most brutal fight scenes you'll see on a train in cinema history.
I think it's what go down as the point that like whenever Bond goes against as a big fight with a villain or you know the lead villain, the henchman, they always kind of go, we need to go for Russia Love, you know that fight scene on the train with Red Grant. It always seems to be like the benchmark, or the main inspiration that they always want it to be kind of like that, or that brutal.
Definitely.
Well, they call back to it twice in the Roger Moore era.
Yeah,
they do.
You've got Live and Let Die and The Spy Who Loved Me have got very, very similar sequences. Mm. And they are recalling this. Not like this, they are recalling this.
Yeah, I'd say both Roger scenes aren't as brutal as this one.
Yeah. And I remember even GoldenEye when Mark Campbell said the big fight with Pierce Brosnan and Sean Bean, like he wanted something like something along the lines of that. They want to echo that kind of feel to it, that kind of brutal sort of just fisticuffs thing. So yeah, I think that has always been like the classic Bond punch up.
And it still
holds up. You know, it still feels like a believable fight as well.
It doesn't have a lot of that. A lot of the Bond fights of this era have that sort of weird undercranked sort of speeded up effect.
No.
And this has none of that.
No, this is quality all the way through.
Because it's shot so close in, as Becca suggests, claustrophobia. You can tell it's them. I don't think the stuntmen did very much of this at all.
No, he did pretty much all his own stunts, didn't he, Connery and Donald Grant? His name, I can't remember.
Robert Shaw.
Mm.
Quint.
Quint.
Anyway.
Quint von Shaw. He will always be, as iconic as this character is, he will always be Quint over and above this. Yeah, there's no question.
I was going to say Quint, but I thought, no, that's not his name.
Doesn't he buy it by getting stabbed in the shoulder, though? I always found that a bit... I mean, unless I miss it, like, miss something, I just felt like, oh, really? You know, he got stabbed in the shoulder and that's it.
It was quite an epic punch-up, though.
Oh, yeah, it is, don't
I guess you've got to end it somehow. I mean,
I know, but I would have thought you would have gone for like a chest shot or something. I don't know. It just feels like stabbing the shoulder feels like that's like the start of it, and then that's all.
Yeah, damaged an artery somewhere.
At least in Live and Let Die, like Teehee goes out the window, basically.
Yeah, pretty much.
yeah. So it's
yeah. Doesn't Jaws go out the window as well?
Yeah, all done.
Yeah.
Yeah. I,
Sean Bean doesn't.
Sean Bean? Sean Bean doesn't go out the window because he falls off a
satellite
dish, basically.
Yeah. Spoiler.
They could have put a window halfway down just to make the effect of it. Like,
just out it goes.
Yeah.
Poor Sean Bean dying in all his films. Anyway, moving on.
Yeah, so this film must have been really, really looked at by the censors. In 1963, you've got one of the most brutal hand-to-hand fights you're going to see in a film of that era.
You've got gypsies fighting.
You've got gypsies fighting, followed by a very strongly implied threesome.
Definitely.
And a lot of people... See, I've never seen this, and I've got a filthy mind.
You got a blowjob joke as well.
That's the...
And that's the first scene, literally, like... It is the weirdness of that relationship. Like, the first time they meet, Bond literally has sex with her. And
also, I noticed as well, watching it on Blu-ray, you see Tanya's backside on the very first, you know...
Oh, trust me, I saw that on VHS.
I noticed that the first time round, I must say.
Yeah, I mean, you've got full nudity. I've got a
it's fleeting, but it's there. Well.
It's a body double, but I mean, the fact is, it's still female nudity.
You see her ass, oh my God.
You've got a gypsy fight followed by, quite a brutal gypsy fight, followed by a definitely implied threesome.
Then
you've got Chris cutscene out. I've heard other podcasts talk about this scene where he meets with Tanya. It's worth talking about this scene, actually, because it's sort of it outlived Connery as a scene, but we'll come to that in just a second. But in fact, no, we'll come to it now because it's the standard Bond screen test.
That's the one. Yeah, they all do the From Russia Love scene, don't they?
They do. They all do this scene. They do a scene from Majesty's as well. Yep. But they always do this scene, you know, call me James Bond, and he, you know, catches her in bed. And you'll see on various extras discs, Pierce Brosnan doing it, Sam Neill.
Yeah, Sam Neill did it.
Sorry?
Yeah, Sam Neill did it as well. And I seem to remember when Colin Salmon was on Strictly Come Dancing, he was talking about it as well. And that's when he auditioned years and years ago.
Right.
And he had to do that.
You've got to tell that story when we get to that, because I've heard rumours about Colin Salmon and potential casting, but I don't know any.
Well, all I know is, like,
edit it out and we'll do it when we come to it.
All I know is about Colin Salmon is, like, well, during the Brosnan era, he was, like, the stand-in for Brosnan for the screen tests. So whenever someone would
screen tested, say, a Bond.
Yeah, so let's say, like, the Bond girl would, like, be screen tested for the next film, he would be play Bond in the screen test.
Right.
So,
because Sam Neill's screen test, I think it's Fiona Fullerton who was in A View to a Kill, and I know Mariam Darbo tested opposite Pierce Brosnan.
Oh yeah,
she sat in for some of those. But yeah, this scene is see, now I've never, and if a mind as filthy as mine can't see it as this, I do wonder if it was. I did not think this was a blowjob joke. Because he's leaning in to kiss her as he says it.
Yeah.
But everyone else seems to think that he's saying your mouth is the perfect size for my dick.
I mean, I suppose it's that's the wonderful thing. It can read both ways. I mean, a Bond is saying it as literally the same size as my mouth. But then you can kind of understand and it's not like that much of a stretch.
I mean, if to believe that more, it definitely would have been a blowjob joke.
Funny you should say that. I watched that and I thought, like, I know what you're saying about Roger Moore. This plays exactly like Roger Moore. Literally, within like a minute of walking in, meeting this girl for the first time, he's there having sex with her. It's just like,
shakes hands with her.
Sorry,
it's a really weird scene because he shakes hands with her.
It's like, oh, nice to meet you. Well, he's a gentleman, is after all, isn't he?
It is. just like moments before they start, you know, uniting their parts, they're shaking hands. It's really weird. But, I mean, that, you know, this film in general must have been a tough sell in certain places.
Quite risque.
Yeah. Mm. And the thing is that she's all, like, leaning in, like, going, oh. It's like, literally within moments. It just feels like a bit, oh, Jesus Christ.
Is it not called Tarny? I can't do it. Never mind.
For anyone listening, we have minutes of outtakes that attest to that she can't do accents.
I can't do accents.
Yeah.
I like to try, but I can't do it. But still, it's fun.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's a really, really weird scene. The thing that always strikes me about this actress is how young she was. And it doesn't show. People of that era just age differently.
Yeah, I don't know what it is, because, like,
she's about 21.
Yeah, she's so young.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm guessing it must be something to do with, like, the style and probably the makeup at the time as well. Like, especially when filming something. I don't know. I think it might be a combination of the both. But, yeah, I mean, particularly Connery as well. I mean, going back to even Dr. No, I mean, he's like, what, early 30?
When he was filmed.
Yeah.
And it's like, he does not look 30. Well, he looks like someone who is, like, nearly in his 40s.
Albeit,
I mean, he still looks good, but it's like, he still looks like, but I think he just looks like he's been through more stuff.
Yeah, he's a little bit bigger this week than last week as well, but in a good way.
Mm.
There's a little bit more bulk on him this week. He's definitely growing into the role, you know, in a few movies. We'll see him grow out of it.
In more ways than one.
At the moment, he's everybody's on really top form here. What do we make of Rosa Klebb?
Terrifying, in a word.
Well, basically, I always think of her as a prototype to what's the Majesty's one?
Emma Bunton.
Emma Bunton, yeah.
What, Emma Bunton?
Not Emma Bunton, no.
Baby Spice.
The henchman is Baby Spice.
No. Is it
Emma Bunt.
Yeah, she reminds me of kind of like a prototype to Emma Bunt.
You're still laughing at the idea of it being Emma Bunt, aren't you?
Well, yeah, when two become one.
I think she's more impressive than Emma Bunt in terms of her role in the film. I mean, Emma Bunt is very stern looking, but
she is. I mean, she's quite sinister, but I would say Rose Club is definitely. I mean, I don't know what it is. It's just very creepy. I find her very, very creepy, even in the book and the film, and.
Memorable in the shoe as well.
Yeah, terrifying. But yeah, the actress, she's tiny, and in real life is, you know, quite fairly petite. I think that kind of adds to the effect of it, really. So it's a very tiny woman who's capable of horrific death. Oh no.
Well, she just feels very evil and kind of
like Poison Dwarf.
Yeah, angry.
You said that because I thought of it and thought better of it.
Sorry, you can edit.
That's all right.
So what do you say?
I said Poison Dwarf.
Poison Dwarf.
We can edit it out, please.
I just had a flash of Don't Look Now.
Well, yeah, this is it. That's what I was thinking.
I think her main scene, I mean, apart from like the stuff with Blofeld and that, you know, kicking scene with Bond. It is the bit with Tatiana when she's literally like given a mission. She's kind of like coming onto her and kind of being sort of strongly aggressive with her, kind of like, well, if you speak to anyone, you'll be shot. And it's like, she pretty much like, okay, well, you got this, we've got off you this job, which will lead you in a very, very high position with the Russian government, and what if I refuse, then you will be killed. Pretty much like, oh, right, well.
She's got no choice, really.
Yeah. It's kind of like, you know that she'll be killed when if it goes to success anyway, because it's like, you know, she didn't really work for the Russian government.
She doesn't know that, though, does she?
No.
Spectre kind of putting the screws on Cleb, and then she's in return laying on Tatiana saying, right, if you don't do this, you will be shot.
You'll be shot.
She does look like she's wearing joke shop glasses in that scene.
She does a little bit.
Yeah, she'd have gone Specsavers. she's always been like a very sort of memorable like character, like in appearance and it just always striking as well. When you got like
when you think of all the classic Bond villains, she inevitably pops up.
Mm. But I also like little touches of her kind of sort of shitting herself when like Blofeld's there going like, I do not tolerate failure.
It's so sweaty as well.
The action when Bronstein dies is she is terrified.
Sweating bullets.
But that's a common thing as well when it comes to like Blofeld or these type of villains is when they're kind of telling off and it's like implying that like that person's fucked up and really they're going to kill the other guy. It happens in Thunderball. I think it happens like maybe another couple of times. But another thing I noticed about this scene, I always thought it was Blofeld who kicked him under the table, but it actually isn't. It's the other dude. He just comes in.
Yes.
I always thought it was Blofeld under the table until this watching.
Yeah, same here.
Noticed. And it's not.
And you know, I don't think I'd ever really caught that establishing shot and realised it was on a boat. I don't think I ever really made that connection.
But you see the camera.
You were finally at an angle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The camera itself is kind of like going.
There are a couple of editing tricks in this particular, or the first scene with Kronstein and Cleb, because when you see Cleb approach his Japanese fighting fish, that's a reverse of a shot from the end of the scene.
It is.
Walks forward. Once you notice it, you can't unnotice it, but it's done fairly smoothly. And they they also had to film an insert with Lottie Lenya. So they filmed her against a blank screen and then cut her in front of herself to film another. It's, there's some really interesting editing tricks in this film again.
Clever as well. Like at the beginning when they go through the Spectre training camp, I didn't realise this, but they kind of they go through the gamut and then they do another shot, but they're practically entering the same area. But
it looked like they're going into the second area.
By the way, I love that must have been like the first time that whole trope of like the spy training camp where people got flamethrowers and all and like ninja suits. Yeah, it was like. But the whole
but there's no scenes of them all training to order the right wine to go with fish.
No,
no, that's what they don't.
Only the British government do that. Only the British government.
Yeah, only Bond. Only the below section know that. That's need to know basis.
So yeah, the funny thing is, I always thought these you know little tricks were part of a tight budget, but certainly. In listening to Terence Young talking about it, he was perfectly satisfied with his budget. He said it was a nice budget, and it allowed him to do everything he wanted to do. But what else does this film introduce to the Bond series for the first time? Venice, which we see again and again through the Bond series. Istanbul, which appears in several entries in the series as we go forward. Bond on a train. Can we think of any others?
Bond on a train. It sounds like film in itself, doesn't it?
Bond on a train.
Yeah.
Go on then, tell us.
No, I was literally asking what else is there at this point that...
Well, Blofeld,
what
really.
What did we see for the first pre-titles?
Yeah, Blofeld.
And again, that was post-production editing from Peter Hunt. He said, let's put that the other side of the music.
Yeah, it started the trend, didn't it? So that was quite good.
That's the trend.
Yeah, if you answered in a couple of
really episodes. Takes off next week. What else have we got? We've got the first Desmond Llewellyn Q scene. We've got the first shot of Venice.
We've got
first shot of Istanbul.
We got Blofeld stroking his cat.
Blofeld stroking a white cat.
White kitty cat.
Yeah, but that whole thing is iconic. Is that faceless villain stroking a cat has always been. Even it's very much Bond, but that whole Blofeld thing has come beyond that. It's it's come like the typical, when everyone categorizes like an arch villain who only wants to take over the world, it's always a guy sitting in the chair stroking a cat.
That's it. Yeah.
I mean, like, tell me the amount of times you are like, when you sit in a swirly chair, it's like you wish you could just, you span around and you wish you were stroking a cat going like, so, Mr. Bond.
I was last week when I was recording this.
In your villain chair.
Yeah. I was in a swivel chair with a cat on me. Yeah.
So it was pussy galore then, was it?
Can you just edit in the sound of a tumbleweed over there?
I'll just edit. It's like some really, really horrible sitcom tin laughter.
Yeah, canned laughter.
Oh, do that. Yeah.
That'd be hilarious.
Oh, God. Yeah. It's also, I think, the sort of the henchman we'd almost forgotten about scene.
Oh, yeah.
As well, if you think about Nick Knack in The Man with the Golden Gun and several others as we go along. Bond's won at the end of this film and he's in a hotel with Tanya and all of a sudden there's Kleb again. It's...
Can I come back for one last shot?
Yeah, that kind of started here.
But there's no, like, big base that blows up at the end of this, is there?
No, yeah, Kleb kind of dies and then that's pretty much it, isn't it? So there's no giant explosion at the end.
No,
escape from an underground volcano lair.
Yeah, but I mean, this was a fairly faithful adaptation of the books. All of the first sort of few are. I mean, next week we don't really have a lair as such.
No.
At the end of the film, nor do we the week after that. I mean, really, that trope kicked off with the sort of fifth film in the series. Even then, it's not always got the feeling of a lair. When we get to Majesty's, it's just where Blofeld's
operates.
Doing what he does.
Yeah, it's not really his lair, is it? So
it's not one big open space like you get in a lot of these films, but...
Kind of like another Bond trope that kind of really outlived, but you don't really see much of it. As I say, I just make a casual joke about a hollowed-out volcano lair, but that happens once. You don't ever see that kind of thing again, maybe. But
a very sizable lair... with lots of people working on different things. I guess we haven't seen that since Tomorrow Never Dies?
Yeah, probably.
The stealth boat?
Yeah, that's kind of like a lair, I guess. But
Does the Ice Hotel count as a layer?
The what, sorry?
The Ice Hotel.
Dine of the Day?
Yes.
yeah. Thanks for bringing that up.
Oh, yeah, well, I think, yeah, Quantum, anyway. Quantum of Solace. That ends in that kind of weird...
That really weird hotel.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I guess it, I don't know.
That blows
when
up.
When I think of villains' lairs, I always think of, in Bond films, I always think of very big open spaces.
Yeah.
I mean, as I say, I would count GoldenEye, I would certainly count Tomorrow Never Dies. GoldenEye, definitely.
Soldiers standing around arbitrarily turning knobs.
I mean, Skyfall has a lair, it just is...
To quote Austin Powell.
But Skyfall, has a layer in it, but it's just, like, in the middle of the film rather than the end.
Yeah. I thought you were referring to Skyfall itself.
Yeah, no, like, I mean, well, that is Bond's layer, but, yeah.
yeah, he's got his island, hasn't he, so...
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, when we sort of look at the pacing of this film, though, I don't have any major problems with it. But certainly, from when he meets with Karen Bay, and they go and sort of spy on Kirilenko, when they go underground, right up through the gypsy camp, which I've never been that blown away by, it does have down parts to it. I think really this film kicks into gear when they get on the Orient Express.
Definitely, I would agree with you there.
Yeah, because you got from there, and you got the train, then you got the boat chase. No, actually, no, you got like fight with a helicopter, a boat chase.
A fight with a helicopter.
Yeah, that's incredible. That's a really action-packed scene. Excuse me.
It's the other thing that sort of brings up the Hitchcock comparison, because I can't watch it without thinking of North by Northwest.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's where you got the inspiration from, really, isn't it? So
Hitchcock. We talked last week about how Hitchcock could have easily directed the first film in this series, and I said then. Next week we get to the most Hitchcock film of the series, and this is it. Train settings, that feels very Hitchcock.
Yep.
The acting choices, everything about it. It's a Bernard Herrmann score away from being a Hitchcock film, really.
Pretty much, right. Yeah, definitely. As a Hitchcock fan, I would concur.
I don't know, I think for Hitchcock would pull some more extreme camera shots.
Oh yeah, definitely. They're a lot more trickery and involved, so.
You know.
I think, yeah, there's definitely, I mean, like, flash forward to Goldfinger, you've got like the references between the two films, and
the only cross refer because at the start of Goldfinger he refers to the new Felix lighter.
That's the one.
He refers to Jamaica.
Yeah, that's probably what it is. Okay, yeah. All right, well, never mind. Cut it out and just Dave, say what you said before again.
What did I say before? Oh, it's a Bernard Herrmann score away from possibly being a Hitchcock film. Maybe whether I'm just picking on certain tropes, locations and sets, I don't know. But certainly the whole helicopter sequence is a bit like an inferior version of the North by Northwest scene. Although it was a plane in that scene.
Yeah. I kind of liked how the pilots were all wearing leather.
Yeah. like...
They were like, everything was leather, down to their caps they were wearing.
Black leather, you know, it's the look for henchmen these days.
It's a scene, actually, that the whole helicopter scene, I don't know how you feel about it, but when I think of this film, it's not one of the first things I think of, and I think it runs too long. I think it's almost like, you know, they'd spent a lot of money to hire or buy this helicopter, and they're
going to get the money's worth.
Yeah, they're trying to eke it out a little bit. Apparently, it was a remote control one as well, which I didn't realise, and only through watching the extras and listening to the commentary.
Wow, them henchmen have been really small.
Obviously, you know, it's a big 6 foot.
Sean Connery weren't that big then, was he? They were all basically like Dennis Waterman in Little Britain.
But one of the things that did strike me, and I apologise if I'm being a bit thick, but maybe the film has been a bit thick, but... Like, when Red Grant explains his route to Bond in a kind of attempt to knock him over the head and kill him kind of thing. it's like, he goes, okay, Bond thinks, all right, well, you know, Red Grant's got his escape route, okay, let's get off the train. But he follows it to a T. Now, and it cuts to, like, Spectre saying, like, oh, Bond's escaped, oh, well, we'll go and get him. And it's like, they have it so easy. They know exactly where Bond's going to be. They know exactly what route he's going. It's like, how can he be fit? I mean, sure, yeah, get off the train, maybe, you know, get and then get in that van. But once you're in the van, wouldn't you kind of go off route from what Red Grant had planned? Because isn't that just a bit predictable?
Because it's too easy, that's
why. You know, yeah, exactly. It just feels like, shouldn't you, like, be going to different places to avoid, you know, I don't know, getting detection. Captured. Yes. It just seems like really stupid to me.
Oh dear.
Well, yeah. I mean, to honestly, it might be better off if he just... I mean, to be honest, Bond might have been better off if he just stayed on the fucking train, quite frankly.
I've never kind of understood why he didn't, to be honest.
No,
certainly. But then...
overlooked that part, maybe.
I think that's my personal preferences speaking as well. I think this film starts very strong. I think the whole of the Orient Express scenes are terrific.
Ripping.
I think anything...
apart from this, you know, pill dropping.
Yeah, that's it's the same. I don't know, any sort of Bond film like that. I mean, it's really high quality. Pacing's really brilliant. It's going to have ups and downs, but I think this is why it's endured as, you know, to top many people's lists.
Mm.
That's why it's, you know, been so popular for so long.
We talked about an awkward scene earlier, just after he finds one of the staff on the train come to tell him to come quickly. There's been a terrible accident. And Karen Bay and what's the other guy's name? Karen Bay and the other guy are both dead, obviously, and it's made to look like they've basically killed each other.
Yeah.
And of course, Bond then goes back to his quarters and gets into a bit of a rage with Titania.
Yeah.
And it's a really, really uncomfortable scene because a lot of these early films, they have slaps in them and so on, and I just tend to overlook it as part of its era.
A bit of misogyny.
He really, really belts her in this film. He flat out punches her.
Yeah.
And it's a brilliantly paid scene by Connery because you can feel the seething rising in him, but the way he whacks her is incredibly uncomfortable to watch.
I think it's like, oh, someone comes like a reminder of the fact that, oh, hang on, there's actually kind of, there's an illusion between them two. It's like, you know, you kind of, with it being a Bond film, you kind of just go with it, the fact that, you know, that she's fallen for him or, you know, vice versa. And it's like, you kind of get reminded about, oh, hang on, no, they're kind of playing off each other. So this is the first time where he's like, right, enough's enough, I want to know the fucking truth, you know?
Yeah.
Like, and then, like, you know, what is happening, you know?
Yes, I mean, if you frame it differently as he's hitting a Russian agent,
yes,
then it does play a little differently. But of all this, I mean, there are slaps in a lot of these early films. There's one in my favourite of the early films, but it's the one time where I struggle not to just go as I see it.
Yeah, it does kind of make me flinch as well. I'm not a fan of.
But I think also it also helps you know that she's completely innocent of it as well.
Well, yeah, she's completely in love with him, isn't she, really? And then it's kind of, you can see it played out on the faces.
Both played this scene terrific.
Yeah, it's really, really stand up. And you can just see, like, you know, how angry he is. Like, Dave, you're saying, literally, you could just see it rising in him. Mm. And she's like, no, you know, I'm in love with you. And all I know is that I love you. And you just think, oh, God. But then by that point, he knows that he
girl power.
the other scene I was referring to, with, I don't like the M scene as much in this film, but I do like the second M scene. It's not M and Bond together.
it's a bit that. That might sound with me and M were. That's enough.
M in Tokyo. Yeah. Well then, that's enough, money, thank you.
Yeah, what
happened to them in Tokyo? I want to know about this. You know,
there was a time when me and M were in Tokyo.
I'd like to know more about that. Actually,
yeah, I do too.
Yeah, but doesn't Moneypenny start replaying and he never gets to it?
Yeah, I think so.
I think Bond put that in deliberately just to turn it off.
Yeah, just to annoy him.
Yes.
Oh dear.
Yeah, it's the last Bond film that doesn't, for a long time anyway. But it's the last one of these early ones that doesn't really follow a formula in the same way. Next week, we're nearly there with the final sort of formula.
Would you like to see a Bond film not follow the formula so much like this?
We've seen plenty of Bond films.
Yeah, we've done that already, haven't we?
I mean, in many ways, Majesty's doesn't really follow the formula. Quantum of Solace doesn't.
I think Quantum does.
License to Kill doesn't.
Not in as much as, for example, like Goldfinger is credited with actually cementing the Bond formula, as it were.
I will buy Casino Royale doesn't. But I think Quantum does.
I mean, if you're asking me, would I like to see another From Russia with Love? I mean, if you're talking quality, yes, absolutely. I mean, it's a big drop off from my top two, which I've probably already said in earlier podcasts. Those two are. If not, we'll get to them. My favourite's pretty obvious.
Dine of Day.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know what you're doing.
I find it's the grit. It's the grit. What I love about Dying of the Day is, right, I mean, North Korean prison cells must be amazing. Because basically, right, they imprison you for a year and torture you and you put weight on. basically, they force feed you donuts a couple times a day.
I tell you, North Korea have got in the torture scheme is like they make everything look like a Madonna video.
Yeah,
I think how anyone survives that, I just do not know. Yeah.
See, then you could use Baby Spice for torture. but if you take my sort of favourites, it's normally been around third. That's been challenged in the last couple of viewings, and certainly we'll talk about a few in the next few weeks that I hold in probably just about as high esteem. But when I look at my favourites, it's the first drop off from my top two. I think the top two are fairly close in quality, and it's also the Bond film, as I said earlier, among my favourites I watch least. I like it a lot, but I've got to be in a very certain mood. That this is not cinematic comfort food like quite a lot of the series.
I can put this on any time of the week. I really do enjoy it that much. It's just good, solid entertainment for me that has the right mix of plotting and action and bondness, should we say?
Bondness, yeah, that's a new word.
Yeah.
Is it your favourite, Chris?
What, favourite Bond film? I don't know at this current set. Out of this, not to know, yes. But I don't know. I think my favourite has to fall between Majesty's and License to Kill, actually.
Sorry, what was the first one you said I heard, License to Kill?
Majesty's. On a Majesty's Secret Service and License to Kill. But that's saying it now in episode
We've
3.
We've got a lot of viewing left to do.
Exactly. I mean, who knows? It might turn out to be Dance Forever. Who knows?
It might change. You never know.
If Diamonds Are Forever, this might get truncated into like a 7 or 8 episode podcast. Let's just give up. One of us is clearly fucking mental.
Might be Never Say Never Again. You never know.
Never Say Never Again is really pretty bad.
That's a podcast and a half.
That we will do Never Say Never Again.
I want all my Bond films to have a sequence with arcades. That's
dodgy 80s video.
Oh, do you mean the video game sequence?
Yeah.
Yeah, I actually really like that sequence even now. It has some good things about it. If it was more Ianized, it would be a much, much better film. But we'll get. I mean, it's got some terrible casting decisions in it. But
what, you guys don't like Kim Basinger?
I was thinking more of N.
Oh yeah, he's a bit silly,
Fox,
isn't he?
Is awful in it, and Edward Fox is a good actor. He's just
he's a good actor, but bad.
It's just all wrong for us. Kim Basinger, not really. She's not a very typical Bond girl, but she's fine. Diamonds. This is still. We are still. I think. There's something about the first four Bond films for me, and although I put Majesty's above all of them, you have Pete Connery, and that doesn't, that starts to fall away in his later entries, and you can sort of see, you can see a phenomenon building. I mean, last week we've got a relatively cheap $1 million film, takes in about 60 worldwide. This week we've got a 2 million, it takes in about 80 worldwide, and next week the doors start getting blown off as this phenomenon takes hold. It's really funny that the whole series takes a real turn next week in a lot of ways, in a way that might not have been particularly obvious at the time. It was just the
new Bond entry. He can definitely tell with the change of director that the Bond fight, like Goldfinger, is pretty much the Bond that everyone like knows and loves, really.
Yeah, you can tell with the Guy Hamilton Bond movies. He turns up to 11.
Yeah, I mean, I don't like his later entries, generally speaking, because he is a recurring director. We do get him sort of back in the 70s.
Should we say we get more of him?
But he does do diamonds as well, actually.
Oh, yeah. I always get him confused with Lewis
Gilbert.
Lewis Gilbert, yeah.
Yeah,
both him and Lewis Gilbert have got significant pluses and significant minuses, let's put it that way. I think certainly the Q scene, as we've come to know it over the years, wouldn't have existed had we never had Guy Hamilton come in and do an entry. And Goldfinger is a cracking entry, as we get to next week. It is very, very good. But the series is starting now to become, by that point, much more about these little touch points and milestones through the film that each film has to hit.
Yeah, the Bond that we know today is kind of really formed in these first 2, 3, 4 films.
And it does make From Russia With Love the standout of the four, because, like we say, it's the least a James Bond film of the opening four. And that makes it
all the better for it.
Yeah.
It is better for it, because the funny thing is, as much as I love the Bond formula, nearly all of my favourites deviate from it massively.
Definitely. Otherwise, it just becomes a box-ticking exercise, isn't it? It's like, yep, M scene, check. Q scene, check. Sex scene, check.
It becomes Tomorrow Never Dies.
But yeah, pretty much.
Bond by
But yeah, talking about like favourite Bond films earlier, I think From Russia With Love, definitely. I mean, my top five Bond changes, but From Russia is pretty much always in there in the top three. And certainly it's, I would rate it as Connery's best performance in the role.
Is it ever your favourite?
Yeah, on occasion.
Yeah.
I'd probably rate them.
It was my first Connery. I did hint at that last week, that the first Connery, the first scene I can remember is them underground spying on Kirilenko, or however you pronounce his name.
It's funny you say that. I do remember this being the first one, at least I noticed Connery, when I first established that there were different actors playing Bond, you know. Bear in mind, I was really young at this time, so. And what it's like, when I saw this like being advertised on TV back in the day, it was like, oh my God, Roger Moore looks really young. he looks so different. But you can tell it's like young, but then you're like, oh, it's actually Sean Connery this time. So it's one of the, I think I would say From Russia is the first time I stood up and noticed Sean Connery as Bond, and I still think it's his best film as well, as Bond.
My first was The Man with the Golden Gun. I think my second was the big screen, A View to a Kill. That was certainly my first big screen entry. But prior to this, I'd only seen Roger Moore, really. And I'd probably seen more of his later entries than his earlier ones, when he was too old and they weren't particularly good and all the rest of it. And suddenly you give me From Russia With Love, which is just exquisite to look at. Extremely well acted, really good story, but it was followable. Even as a child, I could follow what was happening in this film. And suddenly, like, this guy who actually looks like he could kill you rather than sort of tickle you to death. And it blew the doors off. And I think I could have endless bad viewings of this film. The last couple of viewings haven't been the best viewings of it I've ever had, but I could have endless bad viewings of this film. And that residual gratitude I pay to it for bringing me into sort of Sean Connery's Bond will always leave it ranked pretty high.
For me, I think I've always stated that this is my favourite of the Connery Bond films. It's kind of odd because Connery is deemed the best Bond, and my favourite of his is the one that's least like a Bond film. But in a weird way, this is kind of how I... It's funny, my favourite Bond film is always the more grittier ones, and this is like definitely the more grittier of the Connerys. It just flows. It just really has a good sense of pace and action, and it doesn't get ahead of itself. It just has everything I need, and it just has rewatchability written all over it. So, From Russia with Love is my favourite of the Connerys, and is one of my favourite Bond films.
Yeah, I guess all I can really do is like echo what you guys have said. I mean, it's pretty much. It's up there in my top five Connery performances throughout his whole movie career, in, you know, inside and outside of Bond. It's probably my favourite, one of my favourite Bond movies, definitely. But yeah, it's got like endless rewatchability. Great score, great pacing, great editing, great sound, great direction. a few dips in plotting here and there. I mean, there are kind of some scenes where it drags slightly, but great performances all round. And again, you're kind of, it's ironic how perhaps the least Bond continues to top the list of favourite Bond movies. So if you haven't seen this film, I urge you to go out and see it. It's fantastic.
And if it does anything, at least it teaches you that you have red wine with red meat and white wine with fish.
Or you're a Russian.
With Bond, you learn how to be a food snob.
To be fair, that's probably how I learned that.
Yeah, me too.
It's watching From Russia with Love. So, there we are.
As well. Obviously, I don't eat meat, but I know anybody who drinks red wine with fish, you think, a Russian spy.
Oh, you're not a vegetarian, are you?
I'm one of those pesky pescatarian people, so I don't eat meat, but I eat fish. There's probably some hardcore vegetarians going, you don't eat fish, blah, blah, blah. But, oh well.
You should try meat, it's nice.
No, yeah, I used to eat it. It's just
a good greasy burger would sort you right out, honestly. and it's a cheeky Merlot with Burger King, by the way.
Actually, that's one of the things I really like about Kingsman is the bit where they have the whole dinner scene. Yeah, it's like, oh, a good choice. It's just like what was it, Chateau with Twinkies or something? It's like, good choice. It's just like, but yeah.
You mentioned sound. Cues us in quite nicely to next week's podcast. Although these are sort of seen as we get into future years as kind of popcorn films, one of the very early films did take home the Academy Award. And was it for sound mixing or sound editing? I forget which, Becca. Do you remember?
Mixing, I believe.
Okay. Whichever it was, it was a gentleman called Norman Wanstall, who was one of the sort of company on these early films. And one of our preferred James Bond podcasts is James Bond Radio, which is available through Stitcher, iTunes, all the other places. And they did an interview in one of their earlier episodes with Norman Wanstall. And if you're hearing this sort of ahead of hearing our Goldfinger podcast, we would urge you to listen to that before that comes along. Becca, you took a listen to it yourself as well, didn't you?
I did. It's fascinating. He comes off as a complete stand-up pro, which he is. Mm. But it's really interesting to learn about how they created some of the sounds and the sound effects. And also his work with Winston Ryder, who is known throughout the business as a really great sound guy. So yeah, I definitely second that, and do give it a listen. It's well worth your time.
So next week the Bond films go absolutely stratospheric in popularity, and I mean, just to spoil it, this film takes 80 million. Next week Goldfinger takes about 125 million.
So yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So it really, next week they go global, and we've got the final sort of bits of the formula coming together.
Well, yeah, like in 1964, you've got Beatlemania and you've got Bondmania as well, haven't you? So.
And 2 years later, you had the Adam West Batman.
Oh God, it was all going on in the 60s.
And Star Trek. Those are the five things that are the 60s to me.
Man from Uncle. Oh, what else? All kinds going on.
I'm talking, if you talk about global impact, though, well, no, you wouldn't even say Star Trek at that time.
Mission Impossible.
It might have flopped. Actually, if you talk about the biggest things in pop culture in the 60s, I would think you were thinking...
Bond and the Beatles.
Bond, Beatles, Batman.
Batman, all the bees.
Yeah. So, that's next week, Becca.
Okay, thanks for listening. You expect us to talk? We'll return with Goldfinger. Yep. We could all chime in and go...